Hello everyone. It's such a privilege to be having this conversation with Zara today on such an important topic. Global Fund for Women focuses its work on three areas: on ending gender-based violence, on economic and political empowerment, and on sexual and reproductive health and rights. And in our work, we don't focus so much on individual women or even on individual groups. We focus most specifically on supporting strong women's movements for change, in the knowledge that it's the strength of women's movements that can lead to the most transformative change. And so our own work over the last 27 years has helped women's movements to end civil wars, get female presidents elected, lead political revolutions, including in the Middle East, and secure new laws to end gender-based violence in some 25 countries, which has given new protection to some 1.2 billion women and girls. And so, Zara, in terms of our work in the Middle East and North Africa, can you share with us the geographic priorities and the geographic focus for our conversation today?
Yes, thank you, Jane, and greetings, everyone. So in the Middle East and North Africa, our three priorities are women's safety in conflict zones and unstable environments, and access to sexual and reproductive health services and laws, and women's political empowerment during times of political instabilities and armed conflict. So as you will see in the map, here are the countries in which we are focusing in the Middle East and North Africa. Since 1989, we have supported over 400 groups in a total of 15 countries. As we can see in the highlighted countries in the map, first in North Africa, from right to left, we have Egypt, Libya, Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco, and Mauritania. And in the Asian side, we have Israel, Palestine, Jordan, Lebanon, Cyprus, Turkey, Iraq, Bahrain, and Yemen. So our current priorities in MENA are Egypt, Libya, Morocco, Iraq, Israel, Palestine, Lebanon, Turkey, and Syrian refugees in the region. Today, we will specifically focus on our three priorities and how these priorities reflect the work of our partners in the women's rights movements in Iraq and Yemen, as well as in Lebanon. Specifically in the case of Lebanon, we'll be talking about the engagement of women rights activists there with Syrian women refugees and girls.
And so I just want to start, Zara, by reflecting on the time that we spent in Turkey, Lebanon, and Egypt last November, and in fact one of my colleagues, Mira, is also joining us with this conversation today. And we were due to fly into Ankara on the day that the bombs hit, so we actually then had to divert to Istanbul. We started our time in Istanbul by joining a convening that we co-funded with the women's rights organization NADRE and also the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. This was a convening of Syrian and Iraqi women activists who came together at a really pivotal time. We brought them together in order for them to capture their own recommendations about what they were seeing and experiencing on the ground to contribute to the upcoming UN Human Rights Committee's hearing on Iraq's human rights record, and also the UN Security Council's review of Syria and Iraq's compliance with UN Security Resolution 1325, which of course is focused on promoting women's leadership and participation in peace building efforts. And that testimony that we heard there was so searing and riveting. And of course, it also related to the wider work that we're supporting in the region. And Zara, it would just be great if you could talk about what we're actually doing in the region that really does commit to contributing to women's safety and security in really challenging conflict zones and unstable environments.
Yes. So in terms of women's safety in conflict zones and unstable environments, one key thing to keep in mind is that threats to women's safety has existed and been occurring in these countries prior to the conflict. What the conflict did is add a new dimension and new sets of challenges to a situation that was already very problematic. So in other words, the brutality of ISIS, al-Nusra, and other armed groups against women, whether state or non-state actors, and this is something that is important to keep in mind, has to be understood as a continuation with bigger proportions, of course, of pre-existing threats against women.
Yeah, I think, and also if you imagine as we experienced inside the camps in Lebanon, if you can imagine going into those camps, there are electric wires that are strung very low hanging so that every couple of weeks someone else gets electrocuted, particularly with the rain coming. And so if you can imagine that degree of instability and insecurity with what families and women in particular, who together with women and with children comprise some 70% of the population in the refugee camps, and if you add to that the exposure to violence more generally within the camps, women said to us in the time that we were there that they often experienced themselves as human shields, and that it was often far better, they felt, for their husbands to hit them than for their husbands to hit out at anyone else in the camps. And so women's sense of their own selves was really challenging in this environment. And so the work of women's groups in supporting particularly Syrian women refugees to understand their rights and how to advocate for their right to be safe and secure to their husbands, and then to be able to form their own support groups within the camps, and also to encourage men to understand that by violating their wives and their children, they're also violating themselves. And so dealing with this situation is so important in the camps. And we also saw a lot of graffiti in the camps, and I asked at one point what the graffiti was saying, and some of the graffiti was reminding girls in particular to scream if a man or anyone grabbed them because of the risk of trafficking in the camps, which had been heightened as a result of just the sheer numbers in the camps. Some, you can imagine, some 25,000 to 37,000 people crammed into less than a mile. And so for a lot of girls, particularly Syrian girls, they're actually usually taught not to scream or yell. So they actually had to relearn their own behavior in order to be able to keep themselves safe in the camp. And I heard about one girl who had, someone had attempted to grab her several weeks before we walked into the camp. And she did scream, and those around her came running. But a lot of girls are actually then grabbed and taken off to the Gulf countries. So that level of focus on safety and security seems to be absolutely critical, particularly for those women and girls inside the camps. So Zara, I know that of course there are many other contexts in relation to the issue of safety in the Middle East. Mm-hmm. And that's just one example of it that we really experienced in Lebanon.
Mm-hmm. And just to briefly list and remind everyone of the main threats, so in addition to what Jane has just mentioned in terms of safety threats to women inside refugee camps, when we talk about women's safety in these countries, we're also talking about trafficking, sexual slavery, direct killing, domestic violence, sexual assaults in the public or private spaces, and forced marriage. So there are a lot of different threats to their safety. And for women human rights activists specifically, this escalating violence and harassment is a big challenge for their ability to mobilize and organize. So our grantees are very concerned about the widespread availability, for example, of weapons at home and in the street, which is making it all the more dangerous for women to assert their presence in the public sphere. And just last week, for example, I was talking to one of our partners in Baghdad, and she said that just on that morning, a bomb had exploded on the route she takes to go to work. Thankfully, she had already arrived in the office when it happened, but these are daily occurrences against which women human rights activists and women in general have to deal with. So now, for example, in Iraq, we're supporting groups within the women human rights movement who are working on a broad range of issues and strategies to address the lack of safety for women and girls. On the one hand, we have advocacy, whether at the national or international levels. And here a group that comes to mind is the Women Empowerment Organization that has led an incredible advocacy effort in cooperation with other Iraqi women groups and worked with the Kurdistan government to increase women's legal protection. They were very successful at engaging both the Kurdistan regional government and the central government of Iraq to develop a national strategy for the implementation of the United Nations Security Council Resolution 1325. which is a resolution, as Jane said, that emphasizes the role of women, the role women should be playing in conflict management, conflict resolution, and peace. So this was indeed an impressive effort of mobilizing women rights organizations and other members of the Iraqi civil society. Another strategy is that also relates to laws is lobbying for the implementation of these laws and lobbying for accountability. So one example, and this is something that our partners are currently working on, is a law that has been an anti-domestic violence law that has been indeed passed by the Kurdistan regional government, but which is amazing. But unfortunately, 4 years now into the law, it is not being implemented consistently. So that's another level of engagement and work that is happening. We also have partners such as the Organization of Women's Freedom in Iraq, who are providing services, social and psychological counseling, legal assistance, case management, etc., for women who are threatened or have survived and escaped from trafficking, honor killing, sexual domestic violence, and who have also recently included refugees and internally displaced people in their work in Kurdistan in north of Iraq. Related to this issue of providing a safe space for women is the absolute priority to establish shelters in Iraq for women who have escaped from violence. This is one of the main challenges is that actually the Iraqi government has been very difficult in approving the establishment of these shelters. And one of the priorities of Yanar Mohammed, who is one of our partners in Iraq, is to establish a shelter for Yazidi women specifically, Yazidi women who have escaped the atrocious violence that was particularly targeting their communities, and for whom it is best for the time being to have a place of their own and not to join shelters where other non-Yazidi Iraqis are.
Yes, and we actually experienced the testimony of a young Yazidi woman at the convening that I was speaking about in Turkey. And if you can imagine these incredible Syrian and Iraqi women activists coming together, many of whom had left very challenging situations, some saying that they wouldn't even be able to return back to their homes after the convening because it wouldn't be safe enough. And in the last day of the convening, in fact, in the last 30 minutes of this three-day convening, this young Yazidi woman stood up, having not spoken at all during the entire convening, and she stood up to tell us that almost her whole family had been killed by ISIS, her mother, her father, her two brothers, that she had been taken by ISIS, as had her sister. She'd been raped multiple times. She'd finally managed to escape and managed to get back to a community where she was being supported. She said that she really imagined that her life would be one within her own community where she would have felt protected and safe and really understood the course of her life. But instead, because of what's happened to her, she realized that she now, for the rest of her life, would have to be an activist on behalf of Yazidi girls and young women, and that this was her first opportunity to really speak out about the experiences that she had endured herself and had heard about from others. And so the opportunity for her to be part of a convening and to join a women's movement so that she could also offer her own testimony for what she'd experienced was incredibly important. And so supporting these movements, and one of the other, of course, important reasons for organizing this convening was to really strengthen the movement of Iraqi and Syrian women activists so that they knew the kinds of strategies that would keep them strong together. And that's also, of course, what we pay attention to in terms of our movement building more broadly. It means that we have to pay attention to where that movement is at in order to be able to know the kind of support that's needed. It might be that the movement is nascent, that it's rising, that it's an established movement, that it's a mature movement, or it's a declining movement. And so, Zara, I know that having this information and insight helps us to recognize the kinds of support that we need to provide these movements at any point. One of the things that we heard from Iraqi and Syrian women activists was that they wanted to build a technology platform in order to support the underground network that they were developing in order to keep women and girls safe from ISIS. And so if you apply that same thinking to Yemen, can you share with us what you see happening in Yemen at present in terms of women's organizing there and the potential for supporting a strong movement in the time ahead?
Yes, absolutely. Yemen is one of our key priorities for the time ahead in terms of engaging much more deeply and closely with women human rights activists there and engaging with the movement. So Yemen is a country that has gone through a tremendous lot in the past 5 years, following the uprising in 2011 and the removal of the former president. There was a brief moment of optimism, and women in great numbers entered politics, were pushing for democratic changes, etc. But the peace process ultimately kicked out the different progressive voices, and among whom were women, of course, and the resulting political arrangement was a clear failure and is one of the reasons behind today's current war in Yemen. So the conflict in Yemen, another big problem is that it is one that is not on the radar of the international community. It's a forgotten crisis, and one that has so far claimed the lives of over 6,000 people. Things are getting worse, and just last month, the Food and Agriculture Organization has warned that 50% of the population are now food insecure. So in addition to all of that, if you then look closer at the situation of women in Yemen, you find that in addition to the war and its repercussions on the general population, you also have to deal with the violence and discrimination that existed against women long before the war, and how the armed conflict has led to violence against women taking much bigger proportions.
Yes, absolutely. And so in support of that, with the other movements that we are really backing in the region, access to sexual and reproductive health and rights is also really important, as well as, of course, helping women's movements to change laws. So in addition to Yemen, of course, the work that we're doing in Iraq and Yemen around this issue is also really important. And it would be great to hear a bit more from you about what we're hearing from our partners in Iraq and Yemen regarding the situation there.
Yes, so issues of access to sexual and reproductive health and rights and the enactment of laws that enable this access to be systematic are problematic throughout the Middle East and North Africa, but particularly so in countries witnessing armed conflicts, especially given the nature of the attacks on women and girls in terms of rape, sexual slavery, and so on. And this is one key priority area where our partners are very active, but are also facing a tremendous lot of challenges and barriers. Among the work that our partners are providing, for example, in Iraq, we have the Baghdad Women Association, who are providing counseling, legal advice, and just helping women to file cases of sexual violence in court. In Yemen, we have the Arab Foundation for supporting women who are working on raising women's awareness for the on the current laws, including laws related to sexual and reproductive health and rights, and what changes, informing women of the different changes that need to be made to make these laws more more responsive. Another issue that is extremely important now is something that a number of grantees are working on, including the Women Rehabilitation Organization in Iraq, is increase the access of refugees and internally displaced women and girls to vital and reproductive health services, such as providing pregnant women with access to prenatal care, monitoring pregnancies, supplying emergency delivery kits, and so on.
Yeah, and I think again about the situation inside the refugee camps when it comes to particularly access to contraception. There's a very high rate of pregnancy inside the camps. Many women coming in, again, particularly from Syria, aren't used to using or even knowing their right to advocate for contraception. In some cases, we heard about women giving birth to deformed babies because of the lack of nutrition inside the camps and the lack of access to health care. One woman spoke about the fact that she was having to medicate one of her babies to almost a vegetative state because of the sheer number of babies that she had, and without access to any kind of health care. So it's an incredibly challenging situation inside the camps. I think that women's groups there are playing a really important role, first of all, in women understanding their choices around contraception, and then getting access to contraception, and then learning how to have conversations with their husbands about their need and right to contraception as well. And of course, then more broadly, supporting women to join women's groups inside the camps so that they feel supported rather than isolated, and that they can more fully exercise those choices in terms of their own rights as well as the rights of their daughters when it comes to sexual and reproductive health and rights. I think what was also really encouraging inside the camps in terms of the work that our grantee partners are doing is we were able to go to a yoga class that was organized by one of the women being supported by one of the groups, and going there and seeing the children being able to use their bodies in a really positive way and to actually feel the difference as a result of them having access to this kind of service within the camps. One little boy said to us, "I feel like I can dream again now that I'm doing this, and I'm dreaming of spirit life and life beyond the camps." And one girl said, "I've made friends now inside the camp, and now I feel like there's a place that I can come to that is safe for me." And so aside from supporting women themselves to be able to exercise their rights in relation to sexual and reproductive health and rights, supporting their daughters and their children to have that freedom of movement and expression, even in the conditions inside the camps, is really critical. And it again speaks to the importance of that advocacy both within the camps as well as then supporting women to be able to use their voices for broader policy change outside the camps. So Zara, I know that there is another key movement that we are focusing on and supporting in the MENA region, and that's women's political and civic empowerment during political instabilities and armed conflicts. So it would be great if you can share with everyone the key strategies that are being used by our partners, particularly in Iraq and Yemen, on this issue.
Yes, and I'm going to be repeating myself, but here again we are dealing with two different sets of categories and challenges, those that have existed pre-conflict and those that have now emerged as a result of the wars and armed conflict. So for the strategies used by our partners in Yemen and Iraq on this issue, we have, for example, in terms of participation in decision-making, it could be as basic as providing literacy classes, awareness on laws, and means through which women can engage local governments, which is what a number of our partners in Yemen and Iraq are doing. And, for example, in Yemen, this is one of the core things that the Arab Foundation for Supporting Women is doing. Another strategy is to facilitate women's access to decision-making positions, develop their leadership capacity, as well as influencing the thinking of current decision-makers in order to promote women human rights and reform or pass new laws that would promote women's political participation, which is what, for example, the Baghdad Women's Organization in Iraq is doing. They're also lobbying for the inclusion of women in transitional governments, councils, crisis cells, local governments, etc. Another very important strategy is engaging the media, whether national or regional or international media. And the Organization of Women's Freedom in Iraq has been extremely successful at engaging the media to raise awareness of issues affecting women. They have a newspaper, have broadcasted popular radio programs. The problem now is that the government closed down their radio station, and they're fighting very strongly to restore it. Another key work done by our partners, such as the Organization for Women Freedom in Iraq, is to fight laws and draft laws that are extremely harmful to women, such as the ones on polygamy, custody, inheritance, and more recently in Iraq, pushing against a law that is called the Ja'fari Law that would legalize the marriage of girls as young as 9 years old.
Yes, and I think that issue of child marriage is a really critical issue that women's rights groups that we're supporting is dealing with, including inside the camps. And there's an increase in child marriage inside many refugee camps as a result of parents wanting to keep their daughters safe and thinking that this is the best way. But of course, the level of violence that a lot of those girls and young women experience inside marriages kind of belies the idea that it's the best way to keep girls safe. And so engaging women in the camps in conversations about what really helps girls and young women to keep safe is really important. What's also important in relation to women's political and civic empowerment, what we learnt about inside the camps was women playing an active role inside the refugee camps rather than being passive recipients of the very limited aid that's available. And so our grantee partners are providing women with access to tools and equipment so that they can create their own micro-businesses, whether it be a yogurt stand, a sweet stand, making curtains, knitting garments, which is really important, particularly given that the Lebanese government has identified some 70 jobs that people inside the camps can't do. And so it means that only the most menial jobs, such as dealing with the sewerage, are available, and largely they're only available to men outside the camps. So when women have the opportunity to earn some income inside the camps, this provides them the funds to be able to support their families' access to basic needs. Remembering that the UN, the main body that's providing aid within the camps is the UN Relief and Works Agency, and its funding has been reduced because a lot of the donors in Europe are pulling back on aid in order to redirect their aid back to countries in Europe. So it means there's less support for those basic needs, which include access to fresh drinking water and access to food. So any form of income that women can raise within the camps is really important to their well-being. Of course, it's also important for women to have the opportunity, once they're able to earn some income, to know that they can use their political voice. They can use it in the camps in terms of organising for the distribution of water and other supplies. And then, of course, they can learn about a greater role they can play in peace processes outside the camps. And so, Zara, it would be great to hear a bit more from you about the role that women's groups are making possible in terms of women's contribution to the greater peace building and peacemaking processes.
Yes, thank you, Jane. So, of course, this is a very important strategy for Syrian women activists and also for Yemeni who are calling and advocating for an official place for women leaders around the negotiation table, whether on peace processes, whether these are led by the UN or by other Arab regional governments or the League of Arab States. And women rights groups in Syria and Yemen have been calling for their effective inclusion for a long time and for their participation. But they remain drastically underrepresented at the negotiation table. And was it not for the support that women peace activists are getting from the Global Fund, from other international organizations, we would not be hearing voices of women from Syria and Yemen and other countries at the international level. Last year, for example, Yanar Mohammed, one of our key partners in Iraq, was able to address the Security Council in New York and talk specifically about the situation in Iraq for women. There are also a number of other initiatives that are taking place, and I think, Jane, you could perhaps also talk about the convening that was organized by MADRI and the Global Fund in Istanbul last year that was also about bringing the different women peace activists together.
Yes, absolutely, and we are looking at supporting another convening with MADRI and Women's International League for Peace and Freedom in terms of sustaining that work and that activism by that network of women on the ground so that they can continue to contribute to the decision making at an international level. I think the other thing that is really important in terms of supporting movements in the region is just recognizing the role of women's groups and movements in serving as an early warning system in terms of what's ahead. And we saw that in Nigeria, where we have been hearing from women's groups for couple of years before the situation with Boko Haram that they needed more funding to be able to strengthen the infrastructure on the ground and to be able to develop the kinds of safety and security nets that were important for women and girls to keep safe. With a rapidly changing situation there and with heightened armed conflict, at the time donors weren't very interested in supporting groups inside Nigeria, and it wasn't really until that situation of the girls being kidnapped by Boko Haram that the global spotlight really focused on Nigeria and the situation there. What we heard from women's groups was if that funding had been provided to movements in advance, there would have been much better ability to be able to resist and respond to what happened there. So thinking about that situation in Nigeria, it would be great to hear from you, Zara, about what you think this commitment to movement building makes possible in the MENA region and what we particularly need to pay attention to now in order to really shore up that support and that scaffolding by women's rights movements in the region.
Yes, and also in order to support women building, we need to first and foremost recognize what the sustainability and growth of these movements entail, especially in terms of financial support, because the majority of our partners in these conflict-ridden countries, as well as in other countries, do not receive core funding from other donors or from many other donors for day-to-day necessities, such as electricity, internet, and so on. And so many of them face the prospect of closing down due to the lack of financial resources. So, and the role that they are playing is one that is vital, as Eugene were saying, in engaging with the grassroots and providing trauma services to rape survivors, advocating for legal reform, access to justice, and for their commitment to conflict resolution and peace building. So, basically, we believe that women human rights groups are the most marginalized asset for peace, and this is why support and solidarity for these groups is of such an importance.
Yes, and I think we have a new opportunity now with the Sustainable Development Goals to really recognize that in order to achieve those goals, there's got to be a much more stepped up investment and contribution to women's human rights movements. And so that is both the challenge and the opportunity to donors in really being able to direct funding and attention to the work of women's human rights defenders on the ground. So I know that sometimes when people listen to anyone talking about the situation in the Middle East, and particularly when it relates to women's movements and women's organizing in the Middle East and in the refugee camps, they might say, well, what can I do as an individual? Well, in fact, there's a lot that you could do as an individual. That includes continuing the dialogue. So anyone that wants to host their own webinar or event or engage with your community can do so. We'd love to be able to speak at any kind of event that you might be organizing yourselves in order to continue the conversation. You can stay connected. You can become an active advocate on social media. You can support organizations that are paying attention to the specific needs of women and girls. And you can also be an influencer. So beyond that direct funding and those direct donations, you can ask organizations how they're supporting the needs of women and girls as distinct from the needs of men and boys. And of course, you can also help to share the load and ask your local politicians what they're doing to contribute to solutions around a refugee policy, including in the US, and let them know that you care about this issue. So there's a lot to do. Stay connected, share, and help make gender equality a reality.
Thank you, Jane.
Thank you, Zara.
I want to let everyone know
that we are now open for questions.
And we have one first that I'd like to offer to Jane. I think it would be wonderful if you could address this. To what extent do you, as Global Fund for Women, help facilitate the creation of, as opposed to discover and support women's groups like the ones that we've been discussing? And so we're being asked if we find that women are forming these groups on their own or that will exist, organizing is there, but it's difficult due to their situations.
Yes, I think the will to organise is there, and I think that our existing the grantee partners that we've been supporting for many years, many of which are kind of anchor organisations for us, play a really important role in supporting new groups to form and in doing that outreach to be able to ensure that that strong movements are sustained in the time ahead. So we've always played a really important catalytic role with strong movements, and I think we'll continue to play that role. But I think it's also been important for us to sustain the strength of current movements and to support those movements that have been working on an issue whose time has come in order to be able to direct further funds and attention to those groups that are really dealing with a tipping point moment and where they need additional attention and support to be able to coalesce and organise. I'd also just like to recognise again our colleague Mira, who's here and who joined the last trip to the Middle East and to the refugee camps. And Mira, also invite you to be able to respond to any questions that we have from those who are participating today.
Yes, hello everybody. As Jane mentioned, I was also with her on her trip, and most of what she described from what we saw both at the convening itself and in the camps was absolutely heart-wrenching, both in terms of the desire to make change and the sheer despair of the circumstances that they were living in. On so many different levels, these women feel very much forgotten. The crisis in Syria has been going on since March 2011, so we're on the brink of the sixth year, and they don't feel like things are improving. The situation in the camps were dire prior to the crises, and now it's crises on top of another crisis. And as Jane mentioned, our role here is to not only respond to the crisis at hand, but more importantly, strengthen the groups that are already on the ground, who are already having their own issues that they were dealing with and circumstances that they were trying to resolve, and making sure that they're able to sustain both what they're doing as well as respond to the current needs as a result of all of these crises, with the understanding that the groups themselves know what they need, the women on the ground know what it is that they need us to support them with, and our role is to respond to them, as opposed to what some of other humanitarian type organizations do. Some have told us we don't want any more blankets. It is simply what they need on the ground. And that's, I think, what is distinctive about the way that we do our work.
We have another question. The question is, are there regional alliances forming, Sara, among women's groups, organizations working in Iraq, Syria, and possibly Turkey?
So a lot of collaboration is happening between Lebanese and Syrian women rights activists, for example, due to geographical proximity, but also historical ties. And a number of our key partners in Lebanon, partners who Jane and Mira recently visited, are indeed exerting a lot of efforts to support Syrian women refugees and activists. There is also cooperation happening between Iraqi and Syrian women, especially because of the fact that inside camps for internally displaced persons and refugees in Iraq, you have many Syrians who fled the war in their country to Iraq, and there again had to flee again inside Iraq from areas that fell to the control of ISIS or other extremist groups, and many of whom went to the north to Kurdistan. So our partners in Kurdistan are also working with Syrian Iraqi women who fled these cities and who sought refuge in Kurdistan in order to work on the needs, on the trauma that they faced, and also on their organizing.
So I'd like to know if there's anyone else who has a question. I'm happy to, if you want to send me a chat, open your mic and you can ask that to our panelists. As we're waiting for those questions to come in, Jane, I've got a question for you, and this is, can you just describe the proportion of funding that you're seeing from donors directed specifically to the MENA region?
Yes, we have actually seen a decline in funding to the MENA region. Donors pulling out because of the level of instability in the region. In some countries in the region, such as in Egypt, of course, the funds are actually being held for quite a long time by the government, which has also meant that donors are pulling out for those reasons. It's exactly the time that more funding is needed for the region to shore up that support, particularly in light of what I mentioned before about European donors pulling back their aid funding in order to be able to redirect it to Europe. And while, of course, the need there is also really important, if we don't pay attention to what's happening in the Middle East, then it's not just something happening on the other side of the world. This is something that is going to, and already is, affect us profoundly in terms of the level of conflict, the course of our lives. We'll lose another generation of people. If people are this desperate, then they'll try and take the first ticket out of there, which means more violent groups, more exposure to extremist forces. And so if we have a true commitment to peace and security in the world, we need to pay attention to what's happening in the Middle East. And the role of women is vital in terms of providing those solutions and providing the leadership for what's needed in the time ahead. We've already seen that with the role of women activists. And so providing more funding to women's rights groups and movements in the region is really important to long-term peace and security globally.
So we do have
I think it's also, I would also say that it's important to advocate to our politicians in terms of the support for the refugee situation in particular, and to really advocate for moral courage at every level so that we're seeing the kinds of decisions that are needed to ensure the justice in the world.
Zara, a question for you. Women's groups were incredibly proud of their role in getting Mubarak out and then getting the Muslim Brotherhood out. So what are their goals now? Can you talk a little bit about what women's groups that you're working with are focusing on at the moment?
So it's basically getting Sisi or the army out. I mean, it's not that we enjoy getting our presidents out, but it's the fact that things have been going from bad to worse. And right now, the main priority is actually to prevent the complete closure of civil society space in Egypt and the space within which women human rights defenders are operating. The situation is becoming very difficult. An increasing number of women human rights defenders and pro-democracy activists are being arrested and prosecuted for the silliest of reasons, like liking a post on Facebook that is against Sisi or the military and so on. So we're really talking about an extreme and ridiculous amount of oppression and authoritarianism that is happening. And so, again, as we were saying before, what women rights groups are doing now is, first of all, still continuing working on the priorities on which they've been working even before Mubarak was removed, in terms of unjust laws, in terms of enacting new laws and making sure that they are being implemented. Recently, an anti-sexual harassment law was enacted, but we have to work a lot in terms of its implementation, especially because of how widespread the problem is. Female genital mutilation has been criminalized, but yet again, its enactment is, we're getting better, but it's still an incredible amount of women, 70%, I think, was the latest statistics of women in Egypt still are genitally mutilated. So we're talking about this, and then we're talking about the new sets of challenges that are happening. And here, regional and international solidarity and networking is extremely important. Last year, a coalition was formed at the regional level, but spearheaded by Nazra for Feminist Studies and other groups in Egypt, was created for women human rights defenders in the region in order to learn from each other, support each other, and international support and solidarity is indeed extremely important. There are a number of cases in which prominent women human rights defenders and pro-democracy activists were arrested, and then through all the outcry that happened at the international level, a number of them were released. So it's dealing with, it's a lot of issues against which they're dealing with.
Yes, and I'd like to, this is Mira again, I'd like to just add a comment to what Jane was saying earlier about not just how funding is directed towards the region, but the region as a whole. Predominantly, people seem to be worried or concerned to get involved in the region as a whole historically, and now it's really a tipping point. One of our extremely knowledgeable and wealthy resource, our advisor in Lebanon, Lina Bouhabib, she mentioned to us while we were meeting with her there that ISIS right now is not only a threat to the women or the people in specific villages or countries, but they are a threat to the very existence of women, both in that region and around the world. And it's a fundamental global threat that we are responsible to respond to. If you think about all of these countries and the changes that they're witnessing, if women are not, if their voices are not heard, if they are not a part of the change, they are eradicated. And that is not an option that we can live with.
Thank you, Mira. I've got a comment and a question from Laura, who notes that she was very moved by, Jane, what you described about teaching yoga to children in the camps. And she asks, is there a place for creative strategies for engagement, and how can they support capacities for advocacy and safety for women?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's interesting. I've spoken to a lot of people now about the yoga in the camps, and there has been such a response to just describing those stories. And I think, again, the work that women's groups that we're supporting in the camps in this regard is so important, because so few of the agencies that are working inside the camps are paying attention to particularly the needs of women and girls. And so the work that we're supporting there is really important, because it, again, it isn't just focusing on supporting women to deal with a level of violence and the desperation in the camps. It's providing women and girls with strategies to be able to break out, even in their own minds and in their own bodies in that way. And it's so vitally important. So if you're supporting Global Fund for Women, some of the money that that's going to these grantee partners will be going to actually support and expand that kind of work. And I need to just say here that what we heard very clearly from women's groups that we've been supporting, not just in the camps but in the rest of the Middle East, they were saying, we don't need just $20,000 or $30,000 as a grant. We need 10 times that to be able to be effective and to be a strong movement in response to what we're experiencing and seeing. And as Mira said, we are really supporting groups that have been operating for a long time, who've expanded their work and their strategies to embrace the situation with refugee partners. And it's why they're so effective, because they have that connectivity between groups, and because they know what's needed and how best to support women and girls to know and act on their rights.
Thanks so much, Jane. And I just want to mention regarding Mira's comment that our advisor, Lina Bouhabib, will be in New York City, and we're in the process of coordinating several different events with her. So if you have an interest in joining us in conversation with Lina in March in either New York or DC, you can reach out to our regional director on the East Coast, Eva Kolodner, and or me, Chandra Alexander at Global Fund for Women, and we would be more than happy to continue that conversation. I think we have...
And I just have to say that Lina is one of the most phenomenal activists I've ever met in my life. So I really hope that you can join the opportunities to interact with her.
Great, thanks, Jane. I think we have time for one more question here. And we've got a question about the level of access that women groups in these regions have to technology and media, noting that access to the web, of course, can sometimes be incredibly helpful in supporting the movements that we're discussing. So what might be the role of technology, or lack thereof, in the progression of women's rights in the region? So Zara, could you try and address that for us, please? I think your perspective would be really valuable.
Yes, so definitely, to a great extent, technology has been very helpful. And by technology, I mean the internet, but also the fact that smartphones are now more and more available, and what this has created in adding a level of protection. In many cases, we've seen women rights defenders who were arrested and who were able to alert to alert lawyers and other people working with them. The same case in the same case when it comes to sexual violence, and being able to alert and then garner support at the national, regional, or international level. And in terms of social media, again, because of the limited to a certain degree, limited technological skills, etc. The fact that now social media, Facebook, Twitter is accessible as opposed to websites that are more complicated, we've seen a lot more groups who are much more active and engaged through Facebook, Twitter, and which is creating stronger discussions at the national, regional, and international levels as well. The main problem we're also seeing in technology is how governments are using technology to repress and attack women, human rights defenders, and pro-democracy groups. And this is something that groups in the region are now very, very alert and attentive to, and are working hard to disseminate information on internet security and how to be able to counter government attempts to spy on them or to build a case against them by accessing their emails, etc.
Great. Jane or Mira, any other comments that you'd like to make? I think we're getting towards the end of our time, but maybe Jane, did you have something to add?
I think that what I mentioned before about the recommendation of Syrian and Iraqi women activists to build out a strong technology platform so that they can quickly share information about where there are safe spaces, where they need to dismantle, where they need to organize, is really important. And so that will also be a focus of the next convening that we support. And of course, the more funding that's available, the more support that we can provide for that really important work.
Great. So I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all of you for joining us today, for Jane's comments and Mira's and Zara's. All of your expertise and insights are greatly appreciated. Many of you are writing in and asking questions about the recording of this webinar, and absolutely the recording will be made available for all of you, and we should have that back to you probably by tomorrow, I would anticipate. So be on the lookout for a follow-up email from us. Again, thank you for joining us today, and we would hope that you could share the insights that you've gleaned. Certainly, if you have additional questions or comments for us or anyone on our staff who's presented here today, please feel free to send them our way. And the recording is absolutely something that I think activist friends, refugee volunteers, consultants, anyone else that you might be working with who could benefit from it would certainly find valuable. So again, every month we will be presenting at Global Fund for Women a Voices of Equality call, engaging from 12 to 1 Pacific time around critical, timely, and urgent issues of concern to the women's human rights community. Again, thank you all for taking some time out of your day to be with us. If we could just give you a preview for next month. The next month's call is coming up on your screen right now. You'll see that it's on March 9th, and we're going to be talking about, of course, International Women's Day, our activities around that, and for those of you who are able to join us in New York, we will have and be part of the Commission on the Status of Women. Very much looking forward to seeing you all then and to having you join with us not only next month but in future Voices of Equality calls. Thank you again for your time and for your presence on this particular call. Have a great afternoon.